Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. So happy to be here with you on a Thursday afternoon, maybe a Thursday evening where you are, maybe even a Friday morning where you are. Wherever you are, we're awful glad you're here with us, and we're going to talk about the faith today. But the ground rules or the basis for the conversation will come from you, not from us, because it's an open forum. You are welcome to call. We've got the phones working today. I don't know if you noticed this week, we've been having a little bit of studio trouble, and that studio trouble is related to the fact that we did some rewiring over the Christmas break and wires got crossed, but now we seem to have everything working. So you can call 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. If you're Catholic, you can call. If you're not Catholic, you can call. If you're a believer, you can call. If you're not a believer at all, you can call. If you have a question about the Catholic faith, you want to know about the Bible, you want to know about the saints, the sacraments, you want to know about the person of Jesus, the Trinity, whatever is your question, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884. Second hour, Mark Brumley will be here with us, president of the most important publisher possibly in the Alpha Quadrant. And this hour, Jimmy Akin is our guest. And the phones usually fill up pretty quickly when Jimmy is here. And now that the phones are working, this would be a perfect time to pick up that phone and dial 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Jimmy was here 26 years ago tomorrow, because that was the very first show of Catholic Answers, and I was just reminded of this earlier by Darren, and I thought I'd mention it to you. So that means tomorrow will be our 26th anniversary show. Carlo will be here. But I wanted to just mention that Jimmy's been here from the time it was born, and he is the only one. I think he's the only one in the building, isn't he? From the, maybe Jen. Jen was around. Jen, who was our events coordinator at the time, is still around. But Jimmy's been doing this for a long, long time. And look at that. All the lines full now. Perfect time to call and ask Jimmy your question. Jimmy is senior apologist here at Catholic Answers and also the author of many things, including The Bible is a Catholic Book and A Daily Defense, 365 Days Plus One to Becoming a Better Apologist, and the proprietor of Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World, where all kinds of mysterious things happen. Coming up on 200th episode, I think, might be the 300th episode, we're coming up on with Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. And so we will ask him about that. And we're just going to mention a couple of the things before we get Jimmy on the line here, because we're still working on that, apparently, to get Jimmy on the line. Catholic Answers is going to Canada. And we're going to take a cruise. We're going to start in Montreal. We're going to cruise down to Boston. And that means going up first to get Quebec and Newfoundland and all that. And that'll be July 29th through July 6th of this year, July 29th through July 6th. And you're welcome to come. CatholicAnswersCruise.com is the place to go, CatholicAnswersCruise.com. I have been mentioning this quite a bit, and that's because the early registration period is up midnight on Saturday night, Honolulu time. Midnight, Saturday night, Honolulu time, the registration is up. And so if you go to CatholicAnswersCruise.com and use the promo code Pope Peter, you can still get that. You can still get that discount up until midnight Saturday night. CatholicAnswersCruise.com. Use the promo code Pope Peter. All right. Well, I'll tell you what. We're struggling to get Jimmy on the line, so we went to the bench. And I don't know if that's the way to say that. Go to the bench. But Tom Nash, our good friend Tom Nash, and colleague here in town with us for a few days. Welcome, Tom Nash.
Hey, great to be here and to fill in for Jimmy. I always saw myself, I was a Detroit Pistons fan. You know, we talk about NBA.
But we're not talking basketball, Tom. Well, don't start.
I was thinking of the Showtime Lakers and how, what's the guy's name who used to come off the bench who hit the baseline jumper, was very good on defense, and I'm drawing a blank. But
Michael Cooper.
Yes.
Yeah. So. Yeah. Oh, Michael Cooper. I'm still mad at him about some of his defense of the Celtics.
Yeah. But I say this: if I could be sixth man coming in for Jimmy Akin, not all right. Life could be worse.
I'll tell you what, sixth man, we'll go to a phone call then. So you take a call, and then we'll I'm sure they'll continue to work on getting Jimmy on the line. Colin is in Newfoundland, Canada. That's kind of cool. I was just talking about Newfoundland, listening on Catholic.com, our website. Colin, welcome.
Hello.
Hey, we're going to be up your way at end of June, early July. You want to come over and say hello to us when we come by?
Are you actually stopping in Newfoundland, or are you stopping elsewhere?
Somewhere in Newfoundland. Yeah, we're stopping in Newfoundland. I'm not exactly sure where, though. I have to tell you. I don't know where.
You'll be in Nova Scotia?
No? Yeah, Nova Scotia. Yeah,
that's Prince Edward Island? I know, yeah. Know your
where
Canadian
does Pippi
provinces.
Longstocking come from? Where does Pippi Longstocking come from? I know we're going there.
All right. I'm certain on that.
Colin, go ahead with your question. We got Tom Nash here for you.
Okay. My question is, could any member of the Trinity assume a nature that isn't rational or biological, like a planetary or galactic nature, or would this involve a logical contradiction that the incarnation would not?
Yeah, that would be contrary to the divine nature to have something that would conflict with it. Because, I mean, God is omnipotent, right? And God can move the heavens because he made the heavens. Nothing he creates, including time, can limit him. Otherwise, he would not be truly omnipotent. But if you're saying, does God become like a planet or a plant or something other, I would think that would be incongruous with his human nature, with his divine nature, which, of course, the human nature made in the image and likeness of God, that it would not be fitting of God for him to do otherwise. And of course, we only have the one person in the Trinity who becomes incarnate, that being Jesus Christ.
Sorry? I just want to make sure that got to what you were trying to get to, Colin. That made sense?
Yeah. It was just basically like trying to sort out like, I guess it's that humans are made in the image of God and these other things appear not to be.
Precisely. Yeah. And of course, God holds them in existence, right? Whether it's a planet and a solar system or a galaxy or the universe as a whole. But yes, I mean, that he would make them, but that he would be incarnate. How one can be truly divine and truly human, but truly something else that would be incongruous. How does one communicate to others when he is not? He's human. He's fully human. He's not a human person. He's always a divine person. There's the thing, fully human and yet only one person, a divine person. The only fully human man that is not a man but a divine person. So yes, it'd be incongruous too, because you'd be thinking, what's the purpose of God doing that? Because you would be thinking, given the fall, that God is wanting to communicate with his creation, human persons, and therefore, how would that even come off? How would we be able to relate to God otherwise? Not that God can't do anything, but God works rationally. God works according to his nature. God works according to our nature, and therefore, becoming human is logical, where those other things wouldn't make sense for us, because according to those natures, he wouldn't be communicating to us via those non-rational modes.
Thanks, Colin. I said that it's Anne of Green Gables. That's what I was thinking of.
Okay.
Prince Edward Island. Yeah, Anne of Green Gables. That's what I was thinking of. I don't know what this what's up, but we're big in Canada right now because Ava is calling from Nova Scotia, if I have that correct. Ava, are you there with us?
Yep. Hi, this is Ava from Ontario.
Oh, our old friend.
Britain, Nova Scotia.
Yeah. Different province.
What are you doing over in Nova Scotia?
I'm visiting my grandparents in Cape Breton and playing Cape Breton fiddle tunes.
Wow.
Well, that sounds all right. I think we're going to come by and see your grandparents. I don't know them personally, but I know we're going by Nova Scotia, so because we're coming on a cruise there in late June, early July. So would you just please let your grandparents know we're going to be coming by with about, 150, 200 other people, maybe for lunch or breakfast?
Sure.
Okay, thanks, Ava. I appreciate that. That was awfully nice of Ava. Yeah, sure, I'll do that. All right, go ahead, Ava, with your question for Tom Nash.
All right, thank you. So I'm a devout Catholic, and I've been studying apologetics for 3 years, and Catholic Answers has been very helpful in my studies, and I found it to be a great resource for material, so thank you very much. And I've been engaging in debates with Protestant friends and acquaintances, and a Protestant pastor who's a family friend. And a lot of the Protestants I know, they church hop, and I've noticed they gravitate towards the Baptist denomination as well as other Protestant denominations. Mm-hmm. So what I wanted to do was I want to go to Baptist and other denominations' services for apologetics research to see what they do there and what might be drawing these people to those denominations. So I was wondering, as a devout Catholic, can I attend a Protestant service for research? And if I could attend it, would there be certain things that I shouldn't do or not participate in because I'm Catholic?
Yes. Oh, Ava, God bless you.
Wonderful. Yes, you certainly could participate in terms of being for purposes and singing and whatnot, because they're brothers and sisters in Christ, but not to receive communion. Now, number one, they don't believe in the real presence, but when we say amen, it's similar to somebody saying amen or I do on their wedding day, that you holistically affirm all that that system of belief, that group of people believe in. Of course, as Catholics, we couldn't do that. And then people say, how dare you not let people come and receive communion as if it's a mere dinner invitation, and we're snubbing people. It's like, well, no, similar to marriage, this is an affirmation that I am totally committed to Jesus Christ and His Catholic Church, and I affirm all that it believes. And therefore, in this case, not to receive communion, even though it's symbolic, because you don't want to mislead people into thinking the kind of like, I'm okay, you're okay, it really doesn't matter, symbol, not symbol. But no, that there is a clear difference. So yeah, do that. And I suspect, I wouldn't generally recommend this, because some people can be misled or go to these services, and potentially, because they're not as well-formed as you, that's why I make disclaimer to, generally I would not recommend it, but since you're well-formed, that I think that would be fine, and just don't participate in communion. And also, you might want to say, you know, on the whole thing of church hopping, what is it about that? I think that implicitly affirms that they have a different view of sola scriptura than these other people, and therefore they're maybe gravitating to certain churches, and they feel free to church hop precisely because they think the Holy Spirit is leading them, or they got it right with the Holy Spirit in terms of interpreting scripture correctly, and that's why they can go from one to another and not feel bad about it. And I think that implicitly affirms the need for a magisterium, some body, some authority, divinely established and safeguarded, which is, of course, the church's magisterium, that protects that, and it points out that we need something beyond scripture to faithfully interpret it, because otherwise we have lots of people saying it's sola scriptura, and that my understanding of the Holy Spirit is the correct one, and in the process, this is why we have the division we do. So I think it might be an opportunity for you to make that point.
Okay, Eva?
Great. So you're saying it would be okay for me, for a well-formed Catholic, to go there to observe, and you could sing and stuff, but don't take their communion?
Yes.
And should I not say amen there, or is that just for communion?
Well, I guess don't say amen to things that you clearly hear that are contrary to Catholic teaching, like saying, you know, something that maybe in the sermon where they might say Bible alone or something like that, or their creed. It's interesting because oftentimes in Protestant services, like the Episcopals will have the same basic creed, although they understand it differently. But yeah, anything that would be clearly that you recognize as not being, or that would be at odds with the Catholic faith, I wouldn't say amen to. I mean, oftentimes you talk about Baptist services, you might have an amen during the homily, or they would say the sermon, and that would be fine as long as it wasn't, you know, you might be affirming or saying amen to a particular thing. So yeah, nothing that would contradict the faith that you can readily see that. And only if, given that you are a well-formed Catholic, Ava, I would only say that if you feel yourself being pulled away, then I would from the church, then I would stop doing it. But okay. It sounds like that won't be an issue for you.
Thank you, Ava.
Thank you very much.
You're
all
welcome.
Right, back to your fiddle playing. We'll take a quick break right back with more Open Forum on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live with Jimmy Akin is coming right back.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Unplanned, the true story of Abby Johnson.
I would be the youngest director in Planned Parenthood history.
She believed in a woman's right to choose.
I've had an abortion myself, so I don't have any problem with another woman making the same decision.
Until the day she saw something that changed everything.
Tiny, perfect little baby. And then it was just gone.
Now she's pulling back the curtain on the abortion industry. Unplanned.
Available at EWTNRC.com and the EWTN app.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Now I think I could say we've straightened out the technical problems. It's been a tough week technically around here. Thanks for bearing up with us. It wasn't Jimmy's problem, it was ours, but we're happy to have you here, Jimmy.
I'm glad to be here.
Hey, Jimmy, before I go back to the phones, and I will go back to the phones shortly. Will you tell me what's dropping on Jimmy Yankee's Mysterious World tomorrow?
Yeah, we're going to be looking at distressing near-death experiences. So these are cases where people have had a near-death experience. Let's say they go into cardiac arrest or otherwise, and they don't have the everything's rosy on the other side experience. They have one that contains disturbing elements. And so it turns out these are way more common than near-death experience researchers initially realized. They account for something like a fifth Ooh. Of near-death experiences, and that could well be an underestimate. And so we're going to be talking about them and what they do and don't imply.
All right. Okay. That's tomorrow on Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. Emma is in Hayden, Idaho, watching on YouTube. Emma, always glad when you call. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi. So I'm going to reveal something about myself that's really embarrassing. Mm-hmm. I have a mental illness and I hear voices. 95% mm-hmm. of my mental illness is completely under control with medication. Mm-hmm. But I struggle. There's two things that just drive me crazy where I hear voices. Number one is silence, and the mm-hmm. other one is white noise. So when I do my devotions in the morning, I can take about 10-15 minutes, and then I have to get up and walk around, and it's a big struggle for me. And I was just wondering, how would you tackle this, Jimmy? I know you're not a doctor or anything like that, mm-hmm. but I've taken medication for it before, and it's worked, but it only lasts for a short period of time.
Okay. Let me ask a follow-up question that will help me potentially. What do these voices tend to say? Are they talking to you directly? Are they telling you anything? Or are they just, is it just like you're overhearing a conversation?
Mostly I'm overhearing a conversation, but they can get really condescending if I'm in a bad place.
Okay. Well, the first thing I'd say, now, obviously I'm not a doctor or a psychologist, so I can't, you know, give you medical advice, but I am aware that not all cases of voices are distressing to people. There are people who hear voices and they're able to live with it, and it's not even always a symptom of mental illness. If you want more information about that, you could contact me offline, off the radio, and I can potentially point you to some resources that might be of assistance. However, in terms of just taking your question at face value, it seems to me that there are a couple of things that I would suggest. The first one is, if silence and white noise tend to be situations where you experience difficulty with the voices, the first thing is, well, you might consider doing devotions in a way that doesn't involve silence. You know, people have recorded rosaries, they have recorded chaplets of divine mercy, and maybe using a recorded devotion that would give you some audio backup for your devotion, in addition to what you're doing with your own voice or your own mind, that might help. So that's a purely practical solution. Obviously, if these are due to mental illness, you want to do what you can to deal with them in terms of conventional therapy. The other thing, though, is if you find them distracting and I would say do your best not to worry about it. When you're doing your devotions, if you have, I'd say do your best to continue with the devotion in spite of them, but I wouldn't beat yourself up if it just gets to a point and you say, I need to get up and walk around. I can't continue this devotion right now. That's okay too. So I would say, don't feel like you're in a double bind. Either way, go easy on yourself. If you can just relax and continue despite the voices, then that's great, and there's virtue in that. But there's no lack of virtue in saying, okay, this situation is getting to be a little much, and I need to go do something else now for my own sake. That's fine, too. God understands that.
That sounds great. Sounds really good.
Okay.
Especially the recorded stuff.
Yeah.
Prayer.
And there are a lot of videos on YouTube of that kind of content, and you can just search YouTube for it and just bring right up a video that you can on your phone or on your computer and pray along with it. Oh, there's also a podcast I might ought to mention called this podcast is called PrayStation Portable. It's basically the Liturgy of the Hours in podcast form. There are a bunch of different files that come with it each day, and you can do whichever files you choose. So that could also be a potential audio devotional resource for you. Once again, it's called PrayStation Portable.
Oh, I love it. Thank you, Jimmy. I knew you'd have some suggestions.
No problem. Happy to be of service.
Emma, thank you very much for the call. As I said, it's always a great pleasure when you call, and I thank you very much. And I hope we'll get to speak again before too long. Every single line full, so onward we go. Cubby is in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, listening on the Catholic Answers app. Cubby, thanks for downloading the app onto your phone. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Yeah, absolutely. And Emma's just up the street from me, I guess. Because I'm in Coeur d'Alene, she's in Hayden. Anyway, oh, yeah. If she's still listening, your Amen app is could be helpful also.
Okay. How can I help you, Cubby?
Question is, RCIA, I'm a faithful Catholic. Mm-hmm. I'm a faith-integrated psychotherapist, and I work with a lot of Christians. And they would like to partake of the sacraments, particularly the Eucharist, and they believe and all that. But the RCIA is just, the lengthy process is just a barrier.
Mm-hmm.
And who can give a dispensation? I'm, familiar with Scott Hahn, where I guess the priest pretty much kind of let him into the church because he's like, more than 99% of the Catholics anyway. Is it the bishop or the priest that can say, instead of attending all the classes, if you go to Formed and watch these 6 videos, then you can come into the church? Or how does that work? Who can give the dispensation?
Okay, it's not formally a dispensation, but in terms of who can give permission for something like that, that's typically the pastor. Now, since your friends aren't yet members of a church, if they're having difficulty with one pastor, they could go to a different church. A different Catholic church and see if the pastor there is more receptive. What I can tell you is that the national statutes for the catechumenate are the document that governs this issue in the United States. And according to the national statutes for the catechumenate, there is not supposed to be a one-size-fits-all program for coming into the church. The full RCIA program is meant for people who have not been baptized and who basically don't have any religious education. But the closer someone is to the Catholic faith, the less waiting and instruction they're supposed to go through. So for example, if someone's coming from an Eastern Orthodox background, they're supposed to be able to be admitted very quickly. If someone's coming from a Protestant background, they'll need some additional instruction, but not a full RCIA course. And so it is supposed to be customized to the individual. Now, in some, for practical reasons, in some parishes, they don't do that, and they kind of mainline everybody through the full RCIA program. That's really not what's supposed to happen, though. And if a parish has the resources to provide a customized program to an individual candidate for reception, then they should do that. So I would talk to the pastor and see what's possible given the situation of these individuals.
Cubby, you can probably hear the music. Thank you. Two calls in a row from Canada, then two from Idaho.
One can also go to the bishop if needed.
Okay, that'll bring us right to the break. As I said, all lines full. Back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin right after this.
Why We're Catholic is the one book you can hand to anyone to invite them into or back to the Catholic faith. With more than 400,000 copies sold, Trent Horn's book has had a number one ranking on Amazon.com for 5 years running. Now available in softcover, bulk cases, ebook, and on Audible. Find out what the excitement is all about. Order your copies of Why We're Catholic at shop.catholic.com or at a good Catholic bookstore. Visit whywearecatholic.com.
If you're not a Bible scholar, the full message of how the Sunday Mass readings fit together can be tough to comprehend. Apologist Carlo Broussard is here to help. Join Carlo every Friday for the Sunday Catholic Word Podcast. In each episode, he unpacks the scripture readings for that Sunday and brings them all together so you can better understand and defend the faith. Visit SundayCatholicWord.com to subscribe. That's SundayCatholicWord.com.
What if the voice of your deepest doubts about Catholicism rose up in the form of a human being and challenged you to defend your most foundational beliefs? That's the task apologist Trent Horn took upon himself in his new book, Devil's Advocate, a dialogue with his own best objections against the faith that he professes and defends. You can stand up against your doubts, and Trent will show you how. Pick up your copy of Devil's Advocate today at shop.catholic.com or at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Our Lord needs articulate defenders of the truth to spread the joy of the Catholic faith. Catholic Answers Monthly Giving Club, Society 315, helps you fulfill the call in 1 Peter 3:15 to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you. For as little as $10 a month, you'll help Catholics grow in faith, bring lapsed Catholics home, and lead non-Catholics to the truth. Go to CASociety315.com and join today.
On the next More to Life, Discipleship Discipline.
Kids driving you crazy? We'll help you handle those annoying behavior problems gracefully.
That's tomorrow on More to Life. Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live, the first groovy music of 2024. Thanks for being here with us. Jimmy Akin is our guest this hour. Next hour, Mark Brumley. Both hours, open forum, and that means open to anyone. If you've got a question about the Catholic faith, 888-318-7884. And, of course, when Jimmy's here, if you've got a question about anything, you're welcome to call. Up next is Aaron in Duluth, Minnesota, listening on our website, catholic.com. Aaron, we're glad you're here. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hello, can you hear me okay?
Very well, yes.
Awesome. So my buddy Jimmy, just finished your 365 daily defense and really enjoyed it, so thank you for that.
Oh, great.
My question, yeah, and so now I'm on to C.S. Lewis's book on miracles, entitled Miracles. And it sort of prompted a question. You know, we're told that Satan can make himself appear as an angel of light in 2 Corinthians, and that in 2 Thessalonians, we hear that he will use all sorts of displays of power through signs and wonders that serve that lie. And in 1 John 4, verse 1, he said, we hear that, dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. Mm-hmm. And so it kind of got me thinking, what, not so much what does the, I believe what the Catholic Church uses in their assessment of miracles, but my question is more, how does a lay person discern between what might be divine and what might be demonic? And aside from, I mean, I think there's the obvious case of like, some Protestants will even point to the apparitions of Mary and say that these are false miracles, if you want to call them that. I don't think the church uses that term, but I think we look to, like, obviously Mary is pointing the way to Jesus, and so it seems fairly obvious that that's probably divine. But are there, are we clever enough to detect those lies? I suspect the devil is spiritually strong, and so just kind of curious on your thoughts.
Well, we're clever because God gave us cleverness. We don't have as much cleverness as angels, but what we do have is God on our side. And so we can trust that in any fundamental matter, God is going to not let the devil win, because that's what God is about, not letting the devil win. You know, not in any fundamental sense. Now, that doesn't mean the devil can't win little victories here and there, but we can, in those situations, use the resources that God has given us. And most of the time, those resources are our knowledge to figure out. Now, God can do other things. He could, let's say you've got the devil deceiving people in a given area. God could always send an apparition, or, you know, to correct what the devil's saying. He could do a miracle to validate that apparition. Things like that could happen. But normally that doesn't. And normally what we do is we use basic knowledge of the Christian faith. There are I would say, two basic ways of discerning demonic activity. The first one involves the contradiction of the Christian faith, because one of the things the devil wants to do is deceive people about the truths of the faith. And so he wants to lead people away from love God and love your neighbor. And so one way that can happen is by promoting false moral beliefs, like, you know, murder is a good thing. You know, Charles Manson got sold on that one. So if the devil is contradicting what we know God has revealed about morality, that would be a sign, if something supernatural is happening, that that it's demonic rather than divine in origin. Then the other way, the other component of this first way, is false doctrine, because the devil wants us to not correctly understand God. And so if a given thing is promoting the idea that, you know, Jesus isn't divine, or that he's an angel, or that there are multiple gods, or something like that, well, then if something supernatural is occurring, then it would be demonic rather than divine. The second major way of detecting demonic activity is aversion to the holy, because demons find the holy painful. For example, in cases of demonic possession, they will be, one of the symptoms of demonic possession is if the possessed person, like, is unable to look at a picture of Mary, or unable to look at a crucifix, or they just find, you know, holy water painful, or things like that. Anything that's holy, they are averse to. And so that's one of the key diagnostic criteria in cases of possession. And so if we see things that are contradicting Catholic teaching, whether on morals or doctrine, and if we see aversion to the holy, that also could be a sign of demonic activity. But you'll notice in both cases, we also have to establish that something supernatural is happening, because sometimes it's not the devil. You can have people who are just mistaken about morality. The devil is not the only source of moral error. Classically, the three sources of temptation are the world, the flesh, and the devil. And the devil's just one of those things. So it could be the world, meaning the example set by others, that's the source of error. It could be the flesh, meaning a person's inbuilt temptations, that's the source of a moral error. Similarly, bad reasoning can lead to theological error, with the devil not involved at all. And some people, without the devil's involvement, can just be averse to the holy, you know. And so we have to establish that something supernatural is going on. We can't just say, oh, well, this is bad, therefore it must be a demon. But if you can establish that something beyond the ordinary course of nature is happening, and that it contradicts Christian teaching, or that it's averse to the holy, that would allow you to have a reasonable basis for promoting proposing demonic activity as the explanation.
Aaron, as you heard, the lines are full, so I'm going to leave that there. I hope that that was helpful to you. John is in Texas watching on YouTube. John, thank you for your call. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hey, Mr. Akin. I hope you're doing well through this letter.
Thank you.
My question is, assuming a non-literal interpretation of Genesis 1 through 3, and that there was death before the fall, how would you answer someone who says, how can an all-loving God allow for billions of years of animal suffering? And in line with that, how do you interpret Romans 8:21 regarding the creation being in bondage to decay and awaiting freedom?
Okay, so the first thing I'd say is that this issue really doesn't have to do with a non-literal interpretation of Genesis 1 through 3. It never says in Genesis 1 through 3 that there was no death before the fall. What it says is God said to Adam and Eve, if you eat this fruit, then you will die. And it also indicated that Adam and Eve had access to the fruit of the tree of life, which would keep them alive. But it you can take a fully literal interpretation of Genesis and think the world was created in 6 days and all that, and it just doesn't say anything here about animal death. It, in fact, implies the existence of plant death, because what else are Adam and Eve going to eat? You know, they're going to eat plants, and those plants that they eat are going to die. So one can have a fully literal view of Genesis and still propose that and understand that that animals and plants did die before the fall. What came into the world through the fall was human death. And that was a position, for example, of St. Thomas Aquinas. And, you know, he didn't have a problem with a six-day view of creation. So you don't have to take a non-literal view here. Having said all that, oh, and also just to touch base, you asked about Romans 8. I think Paul's talking about human creation there. It's like when we say, you know, all creation, I'd have to think of a more specific example, but even we can use the term creation to refer to mankind. And that's just based on what's called the universe of discourse we're talking in. I could say, you know, all creation has heard of Jesus Christ. You know, I mean, all mankind has heard of Jesus Christ. Not every rock and ant has heard of Jesus Christ. So I think Romans 8 is talking about human creation. When it comes to the justice of God in regard to all this, well, faith teaches us that God would not permit an evil if he wasn't going to bring an equal or greater good out of it. And so when God permits animal suffering and animal death, just like when he permits human suffering and human death, he's going to bring out an equal or greater good. Now, that could happen in a number of ways. It could happen for the animal itself. And if you think about it, most animals, they've got a lot of good in life. You know, they have, you know, a long period of good. And then they typically have a death that's short and maybe painful, like if they get eaten by a predator or something, or they have a final illness. But they've got a lot more benefit out of life than they have suffering. And so for most animals, they're coming out on the plus side of the equation. And it's not like God's being unfair to them, not most animals, because they get more benefit out of life than they have pain. On the other hand, even if you propose, let's suppose there is an animal that has more pain in life than it has good times, well, you've got a bit of a question of how God could deal with that. And a classic response would be that, well, animals don't have an afterlife, so they're not going to have it made up to them in the afterlife, but then they don't have rights. And so it's not like God is denying their rights because they don't have any. On the other hand, I think, I did an episode of Mysterious World about this. It's episode 203. So you can go to mysterious.fm/203. It's on animal afterlife. I go through the arguments that have been classically used that animals don't have an afterlife, and I don't find them convincing. I also am aware that we've actually got some evidence for animal afterlife. And so if animals have an afterlife, or at least some animals do, then God could make it up to them in the afterlife for things they suffered in this life, just like he can make it up to us for things we unjustly suffered in this life. So I think fundamentally that set of answers, and I know I provided them rather quickly, but it's the radio. I'm sorry about that. I think that set of answers shows that the problem of evil as applied to animals doesn't really involve God being unjust to them.
John, it's time for the break, so I'm going to leave it there. Thank you for the call. I hope it was helpful. It's open forum. Jimmy Akin, our guest, right back after this.
Hello, this is Archbishop Salvatore Cordiglione of San Francisco. Keep your dial tuned to Catholic Answers Live.
In Morse code, the sequence SOS is a distress call. It's been said that it stands for Save Our Souls. Well, right now our world is in big trouble, and we're putting out an SOS call for help. Will you answer that call? St. Paul Street Evangelization, a Catholic nonprofit, has hundreds of teams who share the good news with souls who don't know Jesus. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. Visit streetevangelization.com to get involved.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
I'm continually amazed and humbled at the way God can work through me to help so many people. Although I have no idea what the caller's questions will be that day, I trust that the Holy Spirit can use my education and experience to guide, challenge, or comfort those who call.
Mast Appeal with Colleen Kelly Mast, Saturday morning, 9 Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
Back to Catholic Answers Live. It's open forum, very, very busy open forum. And Jimmy Akin is our guest. So right back to the phones we go. Vince is in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, listening on our app, the Catholic Answers Live app. Vince, thanks for downloading it onto your phone. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Great. Thanks for taking my question. I am a very long time listener and first time caller. So
well, we're glad to have
you,
Vince.
Appreciate all that you do. Jimmy, I've been a huge fan for at least 15 years, and I'm glad you're on this open forum. I admire your ability to just get to the facts and the truth.
Thank you. And you're very kind.
You're welcome. And I think it's very important for all people to be accurately informed of current events these days so that we can perform our civic duties, as mentioned in the Catechism. And I'm finding that harder and harder these days with the media tending to take on narratives and then going and finding factoids to fit narratives. Mm-hmm. So given your astute abilities, how do you discern what is factual in the news these days? What approaches do you take? And if you're able to share, what news sources do you find most reliable?
Well, okay, so I don't really watch TV news, and I don't really read newspapers. I tend to get my news from the internet. There are several principles that I use in evaluating news stories. The first thing is I don't take the headlines seriously. Because headlines are sensationalistic and misleading. They're basically clickbait to get you to read the story. And they're never as nuanced as the actual story is. Then the second principle is I read the story or watch the story and I cross-examine it. I say, how could this be mistaken? You know, what do they actually document versus what are they just claiming? And what else could be true that they might not be mentioning? So I cross-examine it and and think about, well, what else could have happened that could have resulted in this report? The third thing I do is I check other accounts of the same incident with other news sources that are coming from different perspectives. So if, for example, you know, the New York Times is a liberal newspaper, and if I see a New York Times story on something and I want to discern what the truth is, I'll compare it to a conservative newspaper like the Washington Post or the New York Post. Or if I see something in the New York Post or the Washington Post, I might flip Wall Street Journal, sorry. If I see something in a conservative news source like the New York Post or the Wall Street Journal, I'll check it out with a liberal news source like the New York Times or the Washington Post. The fourth thing I do is I read the original sources. I don't just stick with what's reported or with what commentators say. I want to see the original data in its raw form. So I'll want to look at unedited video of news events so that I could see what happened in context, so that I'm not just being given selective information. And if it's like a church document that people are reporting on, I go read the original church document. I look it up on the Vatican website and I read the original for myself. And then finally, I will deliberately seek out critics, you know, people who take an opposing viewpoint to what's being reported, and see what the critics have to say. So those are kind of the general principles that I use. In terms of specific news sources, I mean, some of them are not really the ones that I consult aren't really sources of political news. Like, I regularly look at Real Clear Science every day, but that's science news. Real Clear Politics, though, is one I have looked at times in the past, and they try to be deliberately nonpartisan. Another one that I look at sometimes, it's an aggregator, is Instapundit, which is kind of a libertarian perspective. But I don't have any one news source or set of news sources that I consider go-tos that I would look at uncritically. I apply my cross-examination principles that I described to every source I come across, because everybody can have bias and everybody can get it wrong.
Vince, thank you. I'm going to keep going, try to get as many on with Jimmy as I can. Jesse's in San Antonio, Texas, listening on the Guadalupe Radio Network. Jesse, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
So, hi, Jimmy. My question is about how to defend the papacy against Eastern Orthodox. Particularly, they don't seem to accept, I guess, Matthew 16, which we might use against a Protestant, and they start talking about like ecumenical councils, and so I just don't really know a whole lot about that, and I know you do, so I just wanted your how would you defend the papacy against Eastern Orthodox, essentially is my question.
Well, I would say a few things. The first one is, it's going to depend on which Eastern Orthodox I'm talking to, because they don't all have the same views on the papacy. So I need to ask questions to understand the concerns that a particular Eastern Orthodox person has. And then I need to address those concerns either off the top of my head or by doing research on them. And there are resources that, you know, from a Catholic perspective, that interact with Eastern Orthodox objections. There was a book a number of years ago by a couple of authors named Lacutis and Whitehead. I believe it was called Ending the Byzantine Greek Schism. There's also a new book that Catholic Answers has coming out by Michael Lofton.
Oh, yeah.
Dealing with Eastern Orthodox apologetics. And I know he's got chapters in that dealing with the papacy. A fundamental thing that I would point out, though, is one of the things that tipped me towards Catholicism rather than Orthodoxy when I was looking at, you know, moving to a historic form of Christianity from Protestantism. And that's the fact that both Catholics and Eastern Orthodox acknowledge that the Pope has a special role. And they both acknowledge he's a successor of Peter in a special sense. But they differ about how the job works. And that struck me as being like the situation in the Old Testament, where Jerusalem had the temple, but the northern kingdom was in separation from Jerusalem. And so, you know, this is the Jew-Samaritan distinction. And so I said, well, who had the better understanding of the proper role of the temple? Was it the people of the southern kingdom in Judah, or was it the people of the northern kingdom in Samaria who were in separation? Well, it was the people from the southern kingdom in Judah. They were the ones who had the proper understanding of the role of the temple in God's plan. The Samaritans, the people of the northern kingdom, unfortunately didn't. And it seems more likely to me that God is going to guide the group that has an institution into the correct understanding of that institution compared to a group that's in separation. So since both groups are agreed that the Pope has a special place in the church, which group is God more likely to guide into a correct understanding of that office? Is it the people who have the institution of the papacy, or the people who are in separation from the institution of the papacy? And it seems to me he's more likely to guide into a correct understanding of the papacy the people that actually have the papacy, rather than the people who are in separation from it. So those are a few general considerations that I would bring to bear on this question.
Jesse, the book that Jimmy mentioned is called Answering Orthodoxy, and I'd be happy to send you a copy. If you just want to hang on the line, Siobhan, who's on the phones today, will be happy to get an address, and we'll send you a copy of Answering Orthodoxy. Aaron's in Oklahoma watching on YouTube. Aaron, thank you for your call. If you could be kind of quick with your question, you'll give Jimmy a chance to answer.
This will be a very quick question. My question is, why does the church consider St. Stephen the first martyr when, in fact, St. Dismas, the good thief on the cross, died first?
Okay, dying professing Christian belief is not a sufficient condition to be considered a martyr. The classic, one of the classic criteria for being a martyr is you need to be killed in odium fide, or out of hatred for the faith, for the Christian faith. And St. Stephen was killed out of hatred for the Christian faith, but Dismas, the so-called good thief, who is been given the name Dismas, even though that probably wasn't his real name. Dismas was not killed out of hatred for the faith. He was being crucified because he participated in a rebellion. And he even acknowledged from the cross in Luke's account of the event that he deserved what he was getting. So he wasn't being killed out of hatred for the faith, and consequently he wouldn't be considered a martyr.
And Aaron, I'm going to leave that there because I think I can get one more on with Jimmy before he's got to go. Anthony in Wilsonville, Oregon, watching on YouTube. Anthony, you're going to have to be quite quick, but we can get you an answer if you're quick with your question. Anthony?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, go ahead.
What's your question, Anthony, real quick?
Yeah, real quick. Why does the Paul V. Audience Hall look like a snake?
Well, it actually doesn't if you go there. What you will see, though, are pictures that have been taken from a certain angle using a certain kind of camera lens that is basically a fish-eyed camera lens that distorts what you're actually seeing. And so it doesn't actually look like a serpent. This is a coincidence that it just so happens if you photograph the hall from a certain angle using a certain kind of fish-eyed lens, then you can make it look kind of like a serpent, but it actually doesn't in and of itself.
Aaron, I will leave that there and say thank you very much for that call. Hey, we got a big sale going on over at shop.catholic.com. It's the 24-24-24 sale. Spend $24, save 24% now until the 24th of January. Just use the promo code New Year when you shop at shop.catholic.com. Use that promo code New Year and save 24%. Jimmy, it just felt so rushed. I'm so sorry that we had a difficulty with you there at the beginning. I'll look forward to our next hour together.
Sounds great.
All right. Thanks, Jimmy. Tomorrow, Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World, it's going to be, do not tell me, it's going to be when you have after-death experiences, but they're not positive after death. I got that right? after-death experiences.
Disturbing near-death experiences.
Yeah, so why don't you check that out at mysterious.fm or pretty much anywhere. Just type in Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World, and you will find it. Thousands and thousands and thousands of other people have. You will be happy you did. Mysterious.fm, or just search Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. Coming up next, Mark Brumley. The president of Ignatius Press. We'll continue with open forum. If you're on the line, stay on the line. If you're not, 888-31-TRUTH. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Thanks so much for being here with us. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. As promised, Mark Brumley is our guest, and we continue with open forum, open to anybody, really anybody. If you're like, I don't know if they want to talk to me on a Catholic radio show, yeah, we do. If you don't believe in God, you want to talk about God, why we believe in God, you want to talk about Jesus, you want to talk about the Bible, and or if you do believe in God, or if you're Catholic, if you're not Catholic, I'm just trying to say anybody can call. And Mark Brumley's an awful nice guy to talk to. 888-318-7884 is the number, but there's only two lines open right now. 888-318-7884. Mark Brumley, of course, is the glorious president of the most glorious publishing house in the Alpha Quadrant, Ignatius Press. You can find them at ignatius.com. Hello, Mark Brumley.
Happy to be with you.
And thank you for wishing me a Happy New Year before we went on the air. Happy New Year to you.
I'm looking forward to 2024 being better than 2023.
You are rocking the sweater, dude.
You think so?
Yeah, that is a nice sweater. I feel quite inadequate now. All right.
Oh, wow. You get that wonderful flannel shirt. You have the cool, sophisticated-looking flannel shirt guy look.
Is that what the sophisticated, huh? Okay. Yeah. All right.
That's right. You look like a Land's End cataloger.
Oh, wow. Man.
For men.
Well, I wasn't assuming that I was in the ladies section. I don't know why you would even think you need to say that. I'm insulted that you felt you had to clarify that.
It's 2024, and we're headquartered in San Francisco.
All right, okay.
One can't make too many assumptions about these things.
This being California. No, I feel quite solid in my my understanding of my place in this scheme.
You have not succumbed to what our Holy Father calls gender ideology.
Yeah, no. The general uncertainty that seems to be afflicting many of us, I haven't yet felt it. I feel pretty determined. Mark Brumley, you know what? I like it when you talk about your books and what's publishing. And I said to you before the show, what do you want to talk about? And you said something completely selfless, not self-serving at all. Completely selfless. What do you want to talk about? Tell us what's on your mind.
We're coming up on the annual anniversary of Roe v. Wade, which has been reversed. There's still much to be done in the United States, certainly in the world, but in the United States, and especially in California, to make sure that every life is respected from the moment of conception to natural death. And we have quite a challenge here in California. So I'm going to urge listeners, obviously, to pray on the upcoming anniversary of Roe, but if you're on the West Coast or even next to the West Coast, come to the Walk for Life West Coast on January 20th in San Francisco. It's going to be a wonderful event, as it is every year. And we're going to have a number of prominent speakers. Lila Rose is going to be there. Let me see who else is here. Kaya Jones is going to be here as a Canadian singer. And she's going to tell her story, her conversion story, the pro-life position, her background. Kimberly Hankel, who is the founder and director of Springs of Love, which is a ministry of support to equip Catholics to help discern and live out the choice, the important choice to be a foster home and to adopt.
So that's very important. And of course, a friend of ours here. We've had her on a few times. We really like her.
Excellent. Yeah, she's doing great work, and she's going to be at the walk. And then, of course, we're going to have Reverend Childress, who is here, I'm going to say every year, but almost every year at least, who is a great Baptist preacher, and he is one of the most Catholic Baptist preachers I know. So,
the rest of it sounds great, but I'll come just for the Baptist preaching. I mean, I'm a Catholic. Every now and then, I need some Baptist preaching.
Yeah, he's a great preacher, and he really knows how to proclaim Scripture in a pro-life, pertinent way. So he is worth more than your book of trading stamps. Let's put it that way. So that's Walk for Life, West Coast, San Francisco, January 20th. Starts at, I think, noon. Let me just check the schedule here just to be absolutely sure. The rally is at 12:30, goes from 12:30 to 1:30. The walk starts at 1:30 downtown San Francisco. And there's a mass in the morning at the cathedral. I don't remember exactly the time. It may be 10 o'clock or 9 o'clock or something like that. So one, and you can come early because information fair from 11 to 12:30. So you can come get the information fair, eat your bologna sandwich down at the Civic Center Plaza in downtown San Francisco, and have a great time.
The romance of the pro-life movement. Bring your bologna sandwich and come march for life.
Absolutely.
All right. Thanks, Mark. I appreciate that. Walk for Life West Coast. Just type those words into your machine. You'll find out all about it. The number here, 888-318-7884. Mark, let me just check real quick. Let me add this up. We have 1 million calls for you.
1 million. Okay.
You ready to take some calls?
Yeah, we'll see how many we can get through.
Okay. Well, we'll start with one. Elias in Magnolia, Texas, watching on YouTube. That's an awful nice name for a town. Elias, go ahead with your question for Mark.
Hello. So I would like to start, say something real quick, then my question. So I'm a Catholic, and you know how in the sacrament of baptism, it is, if a Protestant denomination does it with the proper form, the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, it is valid, right?
Yes.
So my question is, is the sacrament for matrimony the same thing, or is it in some circumstances, something like that, similar? That's my question.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you.
Okay, so, you know, all the sacraments have matter and form, and then they have to have the intention of the minister to do what the church does. So in the case of matrimony, there are words that are exchanged that express the mutual giving and receiving of the couple to one another. So, you know, we have a ready-made form, as you might call it, in the church that, you know, is set at holy in the administration of the sacrament of holy matrimony, which usually happens at Mass, but that doesn't mean that if we have Christians who are not Catholic, so Catholics are normally required to, as we say, get married in the church, which is to say, have the exchange of vows witnessed by a priest or a deacon. There are exceptions to that, but that's the normal way in which the sacrament of matrimony takes place in a Catholic context. But any baptized persons who are free to marry, who, you know, exchange vows according to that form in these other, you know, the Christian churches or denominations, they also have the sacrament of matrimony, akin to how they have the sacrament of baptism. Or we might, to get kind of be a theological stickler about it, Christ's church sacrament of baptism and Christ's church's sacrament of matrimony exist outside the visible structure of the Catholic Church, but obviously it's the same grace of Jesus Christ and the same action of Christ that he bequeathed to his church, his Catholic Church, that makes these sacraments valid even though they are administered outside of full visible communion. So does that clarify, Elias?
Yes, it does. But one little thing. So it depends on if the baptism is valid. So if the baptism isn't valid in that denomination, that means if that same denomination does the sacrament of marriage, it's not valid either, right?
Right. If somebody is, well, let's distinguish. Someone can be validly married without being sacramentally married. So two non-baptized persons, or one person who's baptized and another person who's not baptized, they are capable of being married. But that's not the sacrament of matrimony. The sacrament of matrimony requires that the two persons, it's a man and a woman, I should spell that out nowadays to be clear about that, that the man and the woman be baptized. So if one or both of them are not validly baptized, then they don't enter into the sacrament of matrimony.
Okay. Oh, thank you very much.
Sure.
Yeah, thanks for starting us off. That brings us right to the first break. We'll take a break. Right back with more Open Forum with Mark Brumley on Catholic Answers Live.
There you go.
Let us help you with your question today on Catholic Answers Live.
Do you have a question but prefer to ask it privately? Catholic Questions can help. Go to CatholicQuestions.com to ask your question online, email us, drop us a letter, or give us a call. Longtime Catholic Answers Live apologist and author Jim Blackburn or another Catholic Questions apologist will be happy to assist you. Catholic Questions proudly supports Catholic Answers Live, so visit us at CatholicQuestions.com today. That's CatholicQuestions.com.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
I don't like looking back. I prefer to look forward and keep moving forward. There's plenty to cover. I do a lot of research and try to dig out the bits and pieces of a life or of an agenda that people don't want to talk about.
The World Over with Raymond Arroyo. Tonight, 8 Eastern, on EWTN Radio and Television.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Mark Brumley is our guest, and it's an open forum. You can call if you've got a question about the Catholic faith, Catholic people, Catholic history. You want to know about the sacraments, the Bible. You want to know about Jesus? We love talking about Jesus. 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. And there's two lines open right now. I don't know how that happened, but we have two lines suddenly popped open, and your call we'll get through if you call right now, 888-318-7884. I'm going to Portland, Oregon, where Mirren is listening on KVVM. Mirren, thank you very much for the call. Go ahead with your question for Mark.
Thank you. My question is just, does the church have a moral obligation to be opposed to communism?
Yes. How's that for a... Straight answer.
Could you elaborate a little, please?
Sure. You know, communism is a materialistic philosophy and a kind of a collectivist understanding of human society, human relationships. And the Catholic Church, along with lots of other people, other Christians, and even many non-Christians and other religions, are not materialists. They don't think the world is reducible to matter. They're not atheistic. I should have mentioned that's a key aspect of the Marxist idea behind communism. We affirm the existence. Not only we affirm the existence of God, we see God as the creator and the origin of life and the one who gives purpose and meaning to existence. So that's at odds with communism, which has a different view of human beings and human life. The Catholic understanding of human life is that the material blessings that God has given us can be privately owned. They should be privately owned in such a way that everybody has sufficient access to material goods to lead a decent human life. But that's not at odds with the notion of private property. It's not at odds with the notion of capitalist property. By capitalist here, I'm not necessarily speaking of the economic system, but the idea of having capital, let us say, property that can be in turn used to generate wealth or to create wealth. So these things are all part of Catholic social teaching and Catholic moral teaching. And when communism rejects those things, the Catholic Church opposes that. The other element that I alluded to is that communism is a collectivist, statist way of looking at the world generally. I mean, lots of different forms of communism. I'm painting with a broad brush here, but it's a collectivist, statist vision of the world. And the Catholic Church, while recognizing the state as a natural institution, as the sane institution that is consistent with human nature and is important for human beings to thrive as human beings. Human person takes priority over the state. The rights and dignity of the human person takes priority over the state. The state exists to protect and promote the rights of the human person and the common good of the persons of the community. So ultimately, the state is under God, subordinate to the people, rather than the people being subordinate to the state. So these are some of the ways in which communism is at odds with Catholic moral teaching, and the Catholic Church has an obligation to stand for those things that contradict communism and therefore stand against communism to the extent that it's contrary to true human flourishing and our supernatural destiny, which is to be united with God forever.
Mirren, satisfactory?
I appreciate that response very much. I see a very large spike in communist interest in the younger generation, and I think it's something that we're going to have to reconcile because it's a challenge. But and I remember the old days when Jay Sheen would echo much of what you just said, and I appreciate that. I really do.
Mark's doing the echoing. Sheen. Mark learned everything he knows from Sheen.
I get it. I'm stealing from him outright. You know.
We have a book. Our good friend Trent Horn wrote it with Kathleen Pakalik. It's called "Can a Catholic Be a Socialist?" It will explore many of these themes. If you'd like a copy of it, Mirren, all you have to do is wait on the line. We'll get an address and we'll send you out a copy of "Can a Catholic Be a Socialist?" And of course, communism is subsumed under that wider category of socialism. Let's go to Alondra in Clovid, California, listening on the Catholic Answers app. Alondra, thank you for the call. Go ahead with your question for Mark.
Hi. So my question, I think I already know the answer to this question is no, but I've heard of some people being baptized after their death. So I was kind of wondering how to explain to somebody that that's not possible. So as an adult boy who's 20, passed away, and then weeks later was baptized.
No, it isn't. With some groups like the Latter-day Saints or the Mormons, they have a sort of a proxy baptism for the dead. But we understand baptism to be a sacrament for the living, the people in this life, and that it is a sacrament of regeneration, forgiveness of sins, and regeneration and new life, and that the reception of that through the sacrament of baptism, that reception of that new life, is really something for this life. This life is the place where that new life of grace begins, and it's hopefully brought to fruition or culmination or completion in the next life, in the eternal life with God. It's not something that we can apply to people who have already moved beyond this life. The church has no authority to do that. We have no reason to suppose that that's possible. There is a reference in St. Paul makes reference in 1 Corinthians to people who are baptized for the sake of the dead. And it's not clear what he is referring to there, but he's not referring to a practice, an enduring practice in the Catholic Church or among Christians. It may be some aberrant group was doing this. I have my own interpretation of that, which I won't go into a lot of detail here. But in any case, it's not something that underwrites the church baptizing dead people today.
Okay.
Does that help, Alondra?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes, it does.
Okay.
Alondra.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, we have a little booklet called 20 Answers Baptism. If you want a copy of it, hang on the line. We'll send you a copy of 20 Answers about baptism. And it'll give you, let me count, 20 different answers about baptism. Teresa.
Wow.
I know. I'm pretty good. I'm pretty good at this. Teresa is in the hub, the very center of world civilization. Where is that, Mark? She's in the hub.
In the hub?
Yeah.
Boston.
Yay! Good for you, Mark. Teresa in Boston, listening on the Catholic Answers app.
I had to think about it for a minute.
Go ahead, Teresa, with your question for Mark.
By the way, after the question, we'll come back to me with a statement about Boston because there's a Catholic Answers connection there. So.
Oh, okay. All right. Teresa, okay. That's your signal. Go ahead.
Yes. So my question is, can a couple be legally divorced and remain married religiously and continue to live as if they were married? And both of the couple, like both are Catholics, they got married in the Catholic Church, divorced, and then can they now get back together and living unmarried? And, you know, like, I don't know if that makes sense.
It does make, I think it makes very good sense. I'm looking at Mark's face. He doesn't seem to think it makes sense. What's up, Mark?
Well, no. I'm just trying to understand. So you're asking, can two people
so the question is,
Go ahead.
Yes. Go ahead. Sorry.
No, Teresa. Go ahead.
So the question is: Can two people who are Catholic, got married in the Catholic Church, and right. get divorced, will they still be considered married in the eyes of the Church? And
can they continue marital relations?
Yes.
Okay, Mark.
Continue.
And the answer is yes. It's an unusual situation, obviously, that two people who are civilly married and then civilly get divorced but remain or come back together, we'll say, as husband and wife but don't get civilly remarried. I think that's an unusual thing. I at least haven't heard of many people doing that. But your instinct is right, Teresa, that – you know, when you get married in the Catholic Church, as, you know, assuming this marriage is valid and put in all the stipulations that we want to put in about it, what does or doesn't happen in terms of a civil divorce or even a civil divorce and a civil remarriage has no direct effect, has no effect at all on whether or not the sacrament of matrimony took place. So just because if two people are validly married in the Catholic Church, if they get a civil divorce, that doesn't change their status as validly married in the Catholic Church. Only if there was some defect, so that they weren't, they may have thought they were married and they were presumptively in a valid marriage, and upon further investigation, whatever, they have grounds for an annulment, and they get an annulment. That's a declaration that what looked like a sacramental marriage before was actually null. It wasn't a sacramental marriage. Unless something like that happens, their status as married in the Catholic Church does not change simply because they get a civil divorce. And so it's possible that a couple could, say, be married in the Catholic Church, go through bad times, have a civil divorce, reconcile, morally between themselves, and come back together living out their Catholic marriage, the sacrament of matrimony, get legally remarried or deal with the legality of their civil divorce. It's possible. So it seems to be probably unusual, but it's possible.
Does that get to what you wanted, Teresa?
Yes, but my other question is now, will they be living in a mortal sin by doing that? And can they receive Holy Communion?
If they are validly married, all other things being equal, assuming they're not otherwise in a state of mortal sin, if they're validly married and, they're living as husband and wife is simply what they are. So there's nothing sinful about them having marital relations, even if they are civilly divorced. So long as they're validly married, from the perspective of the Church, they're not sinning by having marital relations.
Okay. And what if they have children? Would their kids be considered, like, out of wedlock, or
no?
What happened?
No. If they're married in the church, they're validly married in the Catholic Church. They're validly married in the Catholic Church. So that means their marital relations are in keeping with God's will. Their children, you know, legitimacy is a different question, but their children are not born out of wedlock.
Teresa, interesting question. I hope it was helpful.
Yeah.
Thank you for the call from Boston. We got to take a quick break, and then I'm going to ask Mark what's his Catholic answer, his Boston connection. We'll do that right after this and take more calls. Open Forum on Catholic Answers Live continues.
When the resurrected Jesus appeared to disciples on the road to Emmaus, they didn't recognize him until the breaking of the bread. The same is true today. In the Holy Eucharist, we really meet Jesus. In The Eucharist is Really Jesus, author Joe Heschmeyer explains how knowing Jesus in the Eucharist is the key to understanding all of Christian faith. Order your copy of The Eucharist is Really Jesus today at shop.catholic.com or get it at a good Catholic bookstore.
Our Lord needs articulate defenders of the truth to spread the joy of the Catholic faith. Catholic Answers Monthly Giving Club, Society 315, helps you fulfill the call in 1 Peter 3:15 to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you. For as little as $10 a month, you'll help Catholics grow in faith, bring lapsed Catholics home, and lead non-Catholics to the truth. Go to CASociety315.com and join today.
Is relativism dead? It sure seems dead. Each day, new moral demands are made and they are presented to us as absolutes. Everything from transgender ideology to physician-assisted suicide is presented as a moral good that all right-thinking people must accept. But Catholic Answers' own Carlo Broussard says look deeper, and you will see today's moralism is just relativism dressed up in new clothes. Carlo's eye-opening book, The New Relativism, shines a light on how the sacred moral teachings of this age cover up a deep denial of moral truth. Order your copy of The New Relativism today at shop.catholic.com and be prepared to defend the truth against aggressive relativism. The New Relativism at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
On the next More to Life, Discipleship Discipline.
Kids driving you crazy? We'll help you handle those annoying behavior problems gracefully.
That's tomorrow on More to Life. Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. A little bit of groovy music on a Thursday. Mark Brumley, our guest, open forum. And one line open, 888-318-7884. We just talked with Teresa in Boston. And then Mark left us with this tease that there's some connection between Catholic Answers in Boston. What is it, Mark?
Well, you know, Fraser Crane was in Seattle and he moved to Boston. And part of his Boston move was he heard a caller on Catholic Answers Live.
That's not true.
And it helped him reevaluate his life spiritually.
Well, Fraser Crane needs to.
Yeah, he went to Chicago too. So, you know, so anyway, but that wasn't the connection. Years ago, Clay Bauer. I don't know if you knew Clay. Clay Bauer used to work at Catholic Answers.
I did not personally know him.
Clay has gone on to be with the Lord, but he was from Boston. And when he was at Catholic Answers, he would talk about Boston, the hub, as the Athens of America.
The Athens of America, right, yeah.
And all kinds of things like that. So,
yeah.
There you go. So, Clay Bauer, rest in peace.
Amen, amen. Yeah, I mean, once you get a little bit of Boston in your system, first of all, you're a better person for the rest of your life.
Yeah,
you're a worse driver, but you're a better person for the rest of your life.
Yeah, I remember. Believe me, I know about that.
All right, I think we'll go back to the phones, Mark. You ready to take another call?
Very good.
All right, let's
go to
Carlos in Fort Worth, Texas, watching on YouTube. Carlos, glad you're here. Go ahead with your question for Mark.
Hey, Mark. So my question is, I have two questions, actually. The first is, I noticed, Emery, since COVID happened, I don't even notice that they are giving out communion wine, you know, at mass as readily as it used to be. I don't know if there's some weird rule or something they have in effect. And the second question, a little more complicated. I know that Pope Francis has granted a plenary indulgence through the, I think, the Franciscan friars. And I wanted to know more about it and how do I go about, you know, getting, I know there's a couple of rules you got to follow and all that. And what benefit does it give, does it grant you?
Okay. Well, I can say a little bit about the second point first. And that is, I don't know much about the particular plenary indulgence that you're referring to. I can tell you what a plenary indulgence is. The idea of an indulgence is the remission, what we call the remission, or making go away, the temporal punishment due to sin. And a plenary indulgence, a partial indulgence, takes away part of it. Plenary indulgence takes away all of it. And we talk about temporal punishment. What that means is, you know, we talk about our eternal fate, our eternal consequences. We're going to be in heaven or hell, and that's, you know, hell is eternal punishment. Punishment means consequence for the choices that we made to love God or to reject God. That's what the essence of hell is. Okay. Temporal punishment is the punishment that will come to an end at some point. And we use the language of punishment. We could use the language of moral consequence. The consequence of our choices bring about suffering in us when we sin. And the church, by the power of Christ, has the ability to help purify or dress those, that temporal or limited consequence, moral consequence for sin. And indulgences are the way, or a way in which the church does that, by the power that Christ gave to the church, binding and loosing, among other things. So plenary indulgences, like partial indulgences, are valuable. They're important. And so I don't know the details about this particular plenary indulgence that Pope Francis has, as you described, granted through the Franciscans, but that's what a plenary indulgences more generally.
I might be able to add a little to that.
Okay,
because this year is the 800th anniversary of the approval of the rule of St. Francis.
Okay, yeah, now so, it's starting to come back to me. Yeah, go ahead.
So as one of the young orders in the Catholic Church, only 800 years old.
That's right.
The Franciscans asked Pope Francis to grant a special plenary indulgence this year to anyone who prays in front of a nativity scene. Because Francis, of course, is the originator of the, or is in large part the originator of the idea of the nativity scene. So I think that that might be the one that our caller is talking about, the special one for the 800th anniversary of the Franciscans, if you pray in front of a nativity scene. Now, and everyone's like, oh, I just took it down yesterday. And now you tell me about this. I apologize. I apologize for that. Go ahead, Mark.
It's probably still up at your church, though.
Yeah, right. Yeah, right. Or at your local, what's it called, town hall. Just don't accidentally pray in front of the statue of Baphomet, because that does not give you an indulgence. Make sure it's the nativity scene. What else was communion wine?
Yes. Yes, you asked about that, Carlos. And my answer is I don't know. I know there's still COVID concern, and as a result of COVID, in some places there's heightened awareness of people spreading germs, and this is cold season. It's not uncommon, actually, in this time of year, for even apart from COVID, even before COVID, for particular parishes or sometimes dioceses to refrain from distribution of Holy Communion, the precious blood under the form of wine. So this is not uncommon. And I think it's just the case that in some parishes or dioceses, because of COVID and concerns, this has been extended. I know here at Ignatius Press, we have Mass every day, and we have communion of both kinds, and so that's you know, we didn't do that during COVID tide, as some people call it. But now that we're out of that, we've gone back to communion of both kinds. So,
okay, Carlos.
Very good. Thanks.
Yeah, Carlos, hang on. I think I misspoke a little bit. I think the nativity scene that you pray in front of, I'm just reading it, it has to be in a Franciscan church. So,
oh, okay.
Which is easy for us here in California because we got all those California missions.
That's right. So we got yeah, St. Francis here in the city, and that's wonderful. So,
Carlos, thanks though. It actually goes all the way until March. So I assume that the Franciscans will be keeping their nativity scenes. That would be mean to take them down if you can get it till March. So unless you have mean Franciscans where you are, you can probably still receive that plenary indulgence.
While supplies last.
Yeah, until before we run out of plenary indulgences. Marble Falls, Texas, that's where Patrick is, listening on 88.5 FM. Patrick, go ahead with your question. Patrick? No? I know that he's there. I can hear him there, but he's not paying attention. We're going to come back to you, Patrick. We'll go to Maria. How can we have two calls from Magnolia, Texas in one day? If Maria is not related to our earlier caller from Magnolia, Texas, I am just going to be shocked. Maybe they got a new Catholic radio station there. Maria, you there with us?
Yes, I'm his wife.
I had a feeling you might be his wife. You think I don't remember? Yeah. All right, Maria, go ahead with your question for Mark.
Okay, so the question is, when was the church born? Was it when Jesus was born, the church is the body of Christ, or in Pentecost, or can it be both in some sense?
Maria, that's a great question. And my answer is, it's neither. The church was born with Adam and Eve.
Oh yeah, that's true, huh? Yeah,
right. So no, actually,
church is born with the universe in a certain sense.
Yeah, that's right, with the universe, right? You're onto something when you said, you know, in a certain sense or in a way. First of all, to talk about the birth of the church, we're using a metaphor. So when you talk about when was the church born, or different ways you can look at it. I mentioned, you know, the first human beings, and there's a way in which we can think of God's plan is to unite all of humanity with himself. So when did that plan begin? Well, it began at the creation of the universe, you know, 13.8 billion years ago, but it also began with the creation of the first human beings. They were the first people that would be part of this community that we call that's going to become the church. But more specifically, we typically think about the church using the image of, or the metaphor of, the church's birth. Sometimes it's associated with the birth of the Lord, birth of Jesus, because he's the head of the church, so the church comes from him. But perhaps more often, we think of the church as being born at Pentecost. In fact, we typically speak of the birthday of the church being Pentecost. Sometimes people will talk about the church being born through Jesus on the cross, when Christ's side is pierced and the blood and the water flow from the side of Christ. The idea that that's baptism and Eucharist, and these things are the sacraments through which Christ forms his people, makes his people. So each of these ways of thinking about the coming to be of the church, the great mystery of the church, has validity to it. So I wouldn't want to say this is the one and only way in which you can talk about the birth of the church. If I, you know, usually when I talk about it, I tend to associate it with Pentecost, because there we have the bestowal of the abiding Holy Spirit of Jesus, which Christ came to give his people. And it really is the abiding Holy Spirit of Jesus that makes the church on earth fully the church, fully Christ's body. Remember, Jesus is the anointed one who's going to, and he's anointed for what purpose? He's anointed with the Holy Spirit to bestow the Holy Spirit on others. And that he does at Pentecost. So that's why I tend to, you know, favor this way of talking about the birth of the church being Pentecost. But the others are valid, have validity to them, as you say.
Okay, Maria?
Okay, thank you so much.
Thanks. That's. Yeah. I mean, come on. Two calls from Magnolia, Texas in one day. That's a good day for us. I got to take a break. I'm so tired. Let's take a break. We'll be right back with more. Mark Brumley, Open Forum, Catholic Answers Live.
Hang on. Catholic Answers Live will return in a moment.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
One of the biggest mistakes a Christian can make is to try to do good without God's help. Saint Therese said, "When we trust only ourselves and not God, our soul becomes incapable of virtue." Her remedy? Works of charity. And the greatest work of charity is to share the gospel. At St. Paul Street Evangelization, a Catholic nonprofit, we encourage you to share the gospel with someone who doesn't know Jesus. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. StreetEvangelization.com.
Are you a new listener to EWTN Radio? Welcome. We're here for you 24/7.
You'll hear live and interactive shows throughout the day to answer any questions you may have about the Catholic faith.
There's trustworthy news from a Catholic perspective.
And a large selection of podcasts available at EWTN's Podcast Central.
And, of course, the Daily Mass, prayers, and everything you need to edify your soul.
Welcome to EWTN Radio. We're blessed to have you with us.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Our guest is Mark Brumley, and I should say thank you to Siobhan, who's on the phones. She's been here 2 hours covering the phones for us. Edgar is out, and Siobhan is a big deal around here. She's the executive assistant to the executive president in the executive. I don't know. It's got the word executive in it like 10 times, her title. And but we needed help, so she came in here, and we're always grateful when Siobhan does that. She's a very, very cool person. Thanks, Siobhan, for coming in.
Oh, Siobhan, that's kenotic.
Kenotic?
Kenotic, yeah.
What does kenotic mean?
Well, kenosis means emptying, you know, like the Lord in Philippians chapter 2 empties himself.
Oh, so she emptied herself and came down.
Take on the form of a servant, yeah.
So yeah.
Very kenotic.
Do you know people who have, like, they really are servant people? They want to be helpful to other people, and that's what Siobhan is like.
Amen.
Super capable and wonderful person, but she wants to help you if she can. And as a person who needs a lot of help to get through my day, I appreciate that. Patrick, we'll go back to Marble Falls, Texas, listening on 88.5 FM. Patrick, sorry we missed you last time. Go ahead with your question for Mark.
Yeah, sorry about that. I was listening on the radio and the phone at the same time.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yes, sir. So my question is about the deity of Jesus. If God is all-powerful and all-knowing, at Hebrews 5:8, it says Jesus had to learn obedience through his sufferings. Well, if he's God, why would he have to learn anything?
That's right. Well, insofar as he's God, he doesn't have to learn anything. But he's also man. And it's how we hold these two things together is a challenge. But we were just talking about Philippians chapter 2, where it says Jesus, though he was in the form of God, thought equality with God was not to be something to be exploited for his own benefit, but instead he emptied himself and took on the form of a servant and being found in the likeness of men. You know, so he took to himself. Son though he is, took to himself a human nature. And living out that human nature in space and time and human history, he subjected himself to limitation that's bound up with that human nature. And part of that is that he had to learn through experience. He was obedient because he's the son to He was obedient to his father, but because he was the incarnate son, that is to say, he was the son who was also living a human way of living, he had to be obedient to the father in a human way of living, and that involves learning through doing. We come to know a thing through a doing of it. And even within our own human experience, there can be different kinds of knowing. I can know how a book is put together, you know, because I've been in publishing for many years. I've seen it happen. I've seen it put together. I've seen videos of the book binding process and so on. So I know it at a kind of abstract level or conceptual level, but it's a different thing altogether to actually be the one who binds a book. That's an experience. And to become a book binder and to learn what that is more than having the concepts or the pictures in my mind. I actually have to do the thing. And so Jesus, in the human dimension of his existence, his human nature, as we call it, had to learn things. And some things he could only know through having the experience of them. And so that's why it says he learned obedience. He learned obedience by obeying in his human life and in his human nature. Something that was true of him in all eternity within the Trinity, when he lives out his human life in this world, becomes true of him in a human way, and that human way involves learning.
Okay, Patrick?
Okay. Can I ask one more question?
Real quick.
Sure.
Okay, so I've seen on the news that the Pope has blessed homosexual weddings. Is that true?
No, it's not.
Okay.
You're willing to go with the short answers on occasion today, Mark.
it's true.
The short is short of it is no. He didn't do that.
He approved a document, and that document talks about blessings, and it says that people with same-sex attraction can be blessed, and even two people who happen to be two people together in a same-sex or who are same-sex attracted can be blessed, not for their being in a same-sex relationship, but in spite of it.
Yeah.
So that's what I would say.
I read the document that came out today, Mark, and I found it very helpful. I don't know if you've read it, but they give an example in there of a divorced and remarried couple asking for a blessing, and I thought the example was very helpful in making clear what they're talking about. Thanks, Patrick. I'm going to try to get the last two callers on. I don't want to have them go away without an answer. So DJ is up next in Jersey Village, Texas, watching on YouTube. DJ, thanks for hanging on. Go ahead with your question for Mark.
Hey, what's up? Big fan of the program. Appreciate you guys having me. I just have a real quick question about authorship. You know, in today's day and age, I feel that Christian authorship has been a little bit difficult to come by. You know, great stories like Narnia or Lord of the Rings. So I was just curious to see, where can one go to either publish these books? Because I feel there's great stories out there that people want to tell, but they don't know how to do it.
Oh.
How can one go about trying to get something published?
Yeah. Okay, Mark?
Don't know anything about that.
How would Mark know? How would the head of Ignatius Press know anything about publishing books?
Fiction is difficult. Mm-hmm. Christian fiction is even harder. Fiction is difficult because people don't – if they haven't heard of an author, you know, they're oftentimes unwilling to take the risk of buying a work of fiction. But if they've heard of the author – we have now – you know, you mentioned Tolkien and people like that. Nowadays, you know, we have Michael O'Brien wouldn't put himself in the same category as Tolkien, but he certainly is a well-known Catholic fiction writer, novelist, and so his books sell well. But other people – who are new to Christian fiction often struggle, and it takes a while. You know, they have to be out there for a while, and they got to get their reputation has to develop and so on. How do people get into doing that? Well, write a manuscript and send it to a publisher. You know, think about the kind of novel that you've written and see, you know, investigate publishers, publishing houses, and see if there's a publishing house that seems to align with the kind of fiction that you've written, and send them a manuscript. We get hundreds of manuscripts a year. We publish somewhere between 40 and 60 new books every year, and we reprint far more than that. So we can't publish everything, and we don't. But we try to publish a fair number of novels. We were talking about this new novel, Exogenesis, during one of the breaks, which is a kind of dystopian sci-fi novel that we published at Ignatius Press. And we've done a number of those. That most of our fiction is not that, but that kind of fiction, but some of it has been. We do murder mysteries. Fiorello de Maria does the Father Gabriel murder mysteries, which I love those books. So there's a lot of fiction out there in the Catholic world, not as much as maybe there should be. And as I say, people sometimes are too risk averse for fiction. But I really encourage people to pick up a Catholic novel, read it, and share it with a friend. There's so much good writing out there, and it can really be spiritually insightful. So that's my plug for Catholic fiction and my advice to people who want to become Catholic novelists. Come up with your idea, write it, and send in a manuscript.
DJ, I'm going to leave it there because I want to get to our final caller in Virginia Beach, Cyrus in Virginia Beach, Virginia, watching on YouTube. Cyrus, do you just go by Cyrus, or do they ever call you Cy?
Cyrus, as usual. Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
I'll try to build this out.
I just think the name Cy is beautiful, but whatever. You go by.
Oh, well, I know you're slightly biased, right?
Maybe a little, yeah.
Yeah. No, it's a great name. Anyways, to my question, because I know we're reaching the end of the hour. My uncle is nearing the end of his life. He's been a lifelong agnostic, and I feel he will probably go all the way to the end without changing faith. I want to evangelize to him, but I fear the stigma that I'm only doing it now that he's lost his edge in his old age. How do you evangelize to the elderly?
Yeah, I was going to say, I wouldn't be too worried about the stigma. You're only doing this because he's in his old age and he's kind of lost his edge or whatever. Do it anyway. I was talking to Cy earlier. My dad was baptized practically on his deathbed, and he was kind of agnostic, maybe, you know, kind of general theist sort of possible, but not, you know, committed for many, many years. And it was by me happening to be in town, and I was on Catholic Answers Live. I was doing the Catholic Answers Live show, and I was sequestered in his bedroom, and he happened to overhear me giving an answer to a lady talking about why Jesus died on the cross and what it means. And he overheard that, and after my many, many, many years of talking to him and, you know, doing my apologetics thing and my evangelizing thing with him, he'd been, you know, not strongly, not hostily resistant, but resistant. It came to light that he had been involved. I knew he'd been involved in the occult for many, many years when he was young, and it scared him. And he thought that God could not forgive him, that what he had done was such a terrible thing. God could not forgive him. And that was really what kind of contributed to his kind of, you know, vague, not getting right with God kind of agnosticism over the years. And we talked about that, and he asked me to explain to him about heaven, and I did. And he asked me to explain to him about hell, and I did. And he said, I don't want to go there. And I said, Dad, you don't need to. And I just basically told him that, you know, there's God exists, love exists, and God loves you, and you can come to know him. So that transformed his life at the end of his life. So I would encourage you to, you know, talk to your uncle.
Cyrus, thank you. Thank you very much for the call. That brings us, as you can hear, brings us right to the end. I hope that was helpful to you. If there's more help we can be to you, give us a call or send us an email at radio@catholic.com. Mark Brumley, he is the glorious president of the most glorious publishing house in the whole Alpha Quadrant, Ignatius Press. Find him at ignatius.com. Mark Brumley, thanks. I always enjoy the hour with you.
Thank you, and everybody go to Walk for Life West Coast, January 20th, San Francisco.
Look it up, Walk for Life West Coast. Be there. We'll see you tomorrow, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.